ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। We are in Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 9, Chapter 4, Ambarish Maharaj offended by Durvasa Muni, text 57 to 63. Okay, so I'll be reading till we come to the purport. Texts 57 to 59. Aham Sanat Kumarascha Naradho Bhagavan Ajaham Kapilo Pantaratamo Devalo Dharma Suri Marichi Pramukaschanye Siddeshaf Paradarshanaham Vidhamanavayam Sarveyam Mayam Mayayavritaham Tasya Vishveshwarasyedham Shastram Durvishaham Hinaham Tamevam Sharanam Yahi Haristesham Vidasyati. Translation. Now Lord Shiva is speaking. Past, present and future are known to me, Lord Shiva. Sanat Kumar, Narada, the most revered Lord Brahma, Kapila, the son of Devahuti, Apantaratama, the Lord Vyasadeva, Devala, Yamaraj, Asuri, Marichi, and many saintly persons headed by him, as well as many others who have achieved perfection. Nonetheless, because we are covered by illusory energy of the Lord, we cannot understand how expansive that illusory energy is. You should simply approach that Supreme Personality, Godhead, to get relief, for this Sudarshan Chakra is intolerable, even to us. Go to Lord Vishnu. He will certainly be kind enough to bestow all good fortune upon you. Okay. So this is just, it's a few words, because the story is linked. We know that Durvasa offended King Ambarish, and then the ever protection of King Ambarish was Sudarshan Chakra of Lord Vishnu. And now Sudarshan Chakra killed the demon and followed Durvasa all through universe. So he went on running after Sudarshan Chakra, from the Sudarshan Chakra, he went on running and went all over the universe, finally came to Brahma Loka and asked Brahma for shelter. Brahma refused. Now he came to Shiva Loka and asked Shiva for shelter to save him from Sudarshan Chakra, to save him from the offense. And the point is that is his worshipful deity. This is Durvasa is partial incarnation of Lord Shiva. And this is his Ishtadev, Lord Shiva. And now, look at the statements of Shiva. No? Shiva is expected to protect his devotees. So look at this shloka. Past, present and future are known to me, to Sanat Kumaras, to Narada, to Brahma, to Kapiladev, to Apantaratama is a great rishi. Sometimes say that he is Lord Vyasadeva in previous birth. Sometimes say that he entered into Krishna Dvaipayana Vyas when he was dividing Vedas and writing Vedanta Sutra commentary. So Apantaratama. Apantaratama means one who is above inner tamas. Apantaratama. One who is above the inner darkness, means self-realized soul, the one who has conquered the darkness of the inner self. So these are all great rishis. Look how he glorified. They know past, present and future. And nevertheless, because they are covered by illusory energy, they cannot understand the Lord fully. They are not able to protect you. Look at these qualified people. These are, they know past, present, and future. I mean, how many of us know past, present, and future? I know also. I was born, I'm going to die. That's past, present, future that I know, for sure. But that's not what they know. They know much more. But they are not able to help when Lord himself decided to punish somebody. When you commit offense to a Vaishnava, even great rishis, demigods, self-realized soul, here, everybody important in the universe is mentioned here. The devatas are here, Sanat Kumar, Narada Muni, Brahma, Kapiladev, Vyasdev, Devala, Yamaraj, Asuri, Maharajis, and so many of their followers. None of them can help. So this is, you know, how Durvasa felt. He came to Shiva's place and said, okay, now I'm here. My own Lord, whom I worship, he is going to save me. And Lord Shiva said, all of us, I know why you came, because we know past, present, and future. We have so much power, we have so much knowledge, no? But we cannot help you. So Durvasa was really disappointed at this point of time. Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur, if I remember, he comments here. He says, to all my tapas, all my pujas, all my austerities today, all went to hell. Means no use. What is the use? No? And it's a, you know, that's exactly what this Leela is showing, that even if you're great rishis like Durvasa, so powerful, you don't mess up with Vaishnavas, you don't mess up with Krishna's devotees. He was powerful. He, from the bunch of his hair, he could create an asura. Phew, what a power. No? It's not for nothing. He had power to see by telepathy, by the, what is modern science we call telepathy, by just by through his mind, powerful mind, he could understand that King Ambarish sipped little water. You look at his powers. I mean, these are just what is displayed in this Leela. Huh? And look at his power. He could go to Brahma Loka, he could go to Shiva Loka. Anybody? None of us can do any, you know. Now it's lockdown. We can't go even out of the temple, which is maybe mercy of the Lord. And still, so much power he puts. And Ambarish never showed any power. We don't hear Ambarish went around the, you know, universe. We don't see Ambarish doing any miracles, any siddhis, nothing. He's a king. He's, you know, doing some puja, some tapasya, some vratas, simply worshipping the Lord. And yet, here, you can see that all his powers, all his knowledge, all his tapas, nothing can save him. And what Lord Shiva suggests here, that you go, you simply approach Supreme Lord. Who is the owner of this chakra? You go to him. Now this is really embarrassing, because chakra is following Durvasa because he offended the devotee. And now you have to go to the Lord of Ambarish to beg for the, you know, excuse. This is so embarrassing, you know. Okay, he could go to anybody, but why to Vishnu? His devotee he offended. How he can go there, you know? It was really embarrassing. Okay, so this was the... And Shiva assured him, certainly he will bestow all good fortune upon you. You go and approach Lord Vishnu. Text 60. Tato nirasho durvasa padam bhagavato yayau vaikunthakyam yad adhyaste srinivasa shriyasaha. Thereafter, being disappointed even in taking shelter of Lord Shiva, Durvasa Muni went to Vaikuntha Dham, where the Supreme Personality Godhead, Narayana, resides with his consort, the Goddess of Fortune. Now look at his power, look at his, you know, ability. He could just walk in into Vaikuntha. All right. Sadahyamano jita shasta vahina tadpadamule patita save patu ahachutananta sad ipsita prabhu kritagasam mavahi vishwabhavanam. Durvasa Muni, the great mystic, scorched by the heat of the Sudarshan Chakra, fell at the lotus feet of Narayana. His body trembling, he spoke as follows. O infallible, unlimited Lord, protector of the entire universe, you are the only desirable objective for all devotees. I am great offender, my Lord, please give me protection. Now, Durvasa is offering prayers, but I'm not 100% sure that we would call this pure devotional service, these prayers to the Lord, because you can see the way he offers prayers. You are protector of entire universe. Why you are protecting only your devotees? Protect me also. That's the prayer. It's a motivated. It's not, I don't know. Suddenly he realized, oh Lord, actually you are protect. Why you didn't chant this prayer before attacking his devotee? It seems like you didn't understand. You did not understood this before. That Lord will protect his devotee. You are protector of all devotees. Look at this now. He said, you are protector of all devotees. Why Durvasa is speaking like this? He said, I'm also your devotee, you know? Kind of, now he declared himself, no? Since failure with Lord Shiva's, taking shelter of Lord Shiva. Now suddenly, I'm devotee of Vishnu also, no? Because for him personally, Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva are all the one and the same. So he said, Lord, you are protector of everyone. And you are protector of all devotees. So count me among your devotees now. You know, it's a little bit motivated prayers, obviously, you know. Why you did not remember that Lord is protector of all devotees before offending Ambarish? Because he carried away by anger, no? When anger is there, then what happens? What's the shloka? Oh, Gurukula is, what's the shloka? Krova bhavati samoha. Samoha, smriti vibrama. Smriti Vamshat Buddhinashat Pranashyati. This is the problem. So this is what happened. He got angry, he got offended. He thought that rules and regulations are more important than the devotional service. No? The rule is there, you have to receive Brahmana. No? You have to treat him properly. You have to respect him. This is what Veda says. And then you identify, I'm that Brahmana. Ahankar is there, and then rules are regulations are why he is not respecting Brahmanas, king. Well, he wanted to please the Lord. Why Ambarish sipped little water? Because he followed 1 year Vrata to please the Lord. So for Vishnu's pleasure, he had to break fast on time. That is the rule of that puja he took. He took Vrata that he will follow perfectly for 1 year, Ekadashi Vrata, and you have to, you know, follow the rule. And the rule is also breaking fast. Parana chart we have given us timings when you should break. Then you get full benefit. And not only you get full benefit, but this is properly done according to Shastra for the pleasure of Vishnu, for the pleasure of the Lord. So to please Lord Vishnu, he sipped little water. So what's wrong with that? It's devotional service. He followed the Shastra. He did not break the Shastra rule. And you should be excused. Okay, for Vishnu's pleasure, he sipped a little water. That's okay. Because who is to be pleased? Who is the ultimate object of worship? Vishnu or the Brahmanas? Vishnu or the Rishis? That's the point. So if somebody is engaged in Vishnu service, why you are now impeding that? Why you are disturbing that? Why you are obstacle, impediment on his proper peaceful puja to the Lord? So if he was Vaishnava, he would not object. Oh, he's okay. Oh, you do Vrata for Vishnu's pleasure. Very good. He will not object. If he is devotee, that makes big difference. But because he was impersonalist, you know, still Ambarish followed the rule. Still he followed that. I don't want to eat. Sipping water is breaking fast and is not breaking fast, by the Vedas declare. So he didn't broke any Vedic rule, he didn't broke the codex, the etiquette, he did not break. But here, because Durvasa is impersonalist, then the problem came. Because he taught smarta, smritis, one who follows smriti is smarta. Means he thought that rules, regulations are more important than devotional service. Though we apply same principle, say like this, you have home deities and you do puja, and now your guru comes, at the door. What you will do? You are in the middle of Arati. So what you are going to do? Are you going to stop Arati and offer pranam to Guru? Or you are going to ignore Guru till Arati is over? What is Vaishnava system? Immediately you stop the Arati and offer pranam to Guru. Why? Because you know, this is the person who is going to take you to Krishna. This is the person who taught you how to do Arati. Without Guru's worship, there is no way that Krishna will be pleased. Krishna will not be pleased. So you stop and offer pranam, and Guru will tell you, no, carry on, do the art, finish. And then you continue with Guru's permit, you continue the art. This is proper. No? Actually, this should be done if any senior devotee come, but they will not, definitely, they will feel very embarrassed if you stop the art, so they will just gesture you. Pranam, you carry on. No? But when Guru comes, you must, you know. So I have this personally little different experiences to learn this. Once there was some program, some festival, so Guru Maharaj was there for some meetings, something was happening. What was it? Maybe Vyas Puja, we were in Tirupati. Anyway, after all the celebrations, I've been asked to give Bhagavatam class in Tirupati temple. So I thought, okay, Maharaj is busy, he won't come, he's meeting devotees, you know, and they asked me to give. So I gave Bhagavatam class, and at the end of the class, Guru Maharaj came in. Just, you know, somewhere at the end of the class. So I immediately sat down from the Vyasasana, you know, offer pranam, and Guru Maharaj, please you come and speak. He said, no, why did you stop class? Just continue, you know. So why did you stop? Just continue. Go on talking. And now it's so embarrassing. You are sitting, Vyasa and Guru Maharaj sitting down, you know. So I came down and it was all this commotion and, you know, it was class stopped, obviously. And Maharaj, no, you continue. So I came up under Vyasa san and they said, so any questions? It was over. Class was over, you know, in 2 minutes. Very embarrassing. So Maharaj said, don't stop the class, you know. Okay. That was what I understood, no, that I should not stop the class. So 1 or 2 years later, again, second occasion happened like that. I am giving summer class. Guru Maharaj comes in the middle of the class. And now I'm not doing anything. Now I saw Maharaj and I just continued speaking like Ramaharshana, you know. If you don't remember that story, you know. So I just continued speaking. And Maharaj said, and I went on, at least this time 10 minutes I dared to speak in front of Maharaj. It was embarrassing, there's no doubt about that. But I just went on, because I remember last time I said, don't stop the class. So, but I saw Maharaj's face. He said, whatever joke I said, there was no smiling, everything was grave like anything. So I understood something wrong. So after the class, I went to Guru Maharaj's room and offered prayer and said, Maharaj, did I do something wrong? Because last time in Tirupati, you know, you told me to continue class. But you have to acknowledge when Guru comes. Yes, I didn't ask you to stop class. But when Guru comes, you should acknowledge that. So then I understood. Oh, okay. So third chance. People speak about second chance. But I got third chance, unwillingly. You know, again I was asked to give class, and sure enough I knew Maharaj is around, he may come any moment, so now I am ready, okay. now I'm like this. So it happened like this. And sure enough Maharaj comes in the middle of the class again, and I say, oh Guru Maharaj, His Holiness Bhakti Kash Maharaj Ki Jai. And I say, Guru Maharaj, would you like to continue the class? No, you carry on. Okay, thank you. And then, this was proper, you know. So you see, it took a little time to understand how to do that, you know. So that was, you don't forget this type of experiences. It's embarrassing, it's very embarrassing. Embarrassing. Okay, so here we are discussing this, that Durvasa Muni is now offering prayer to Lord Narayana. But you can see he's motivated. Now he's scared for his life. Look at Ambarish. Ambarish did not move for an inch. When this demon came, Ambarish did not run away, Brahma Loka, Shiva Loka, Vishnu Loka, asking for help. He thought, okay, Brahmana is cursing me, I have to respect. I'm Kshatriya, I'm inferior. You see, humbleness of Vaishnava. He stood there. But you see, fearlessness of Vaishnava also. He did not move. He stood with folded hands, this big demon. You know, I move when mosquito come, you know, and he's, you know, standing in front of big demon. And so fearless. This is firm faith in the Lord. And then, and Durvasa Muni, what happened to him? Chakra came, run. He didn't stand. Okay, Chakra, whatever will of the Lord, what will of the Lord? Run for your life. You know? So you can see the quality of Vaishnava, quality of impersonalist, whatever tapasvi, whatever knowledge he has, whatever shakti he has, simply scared for his life. Huh? Fearlessness, that's the sign of sadhu, of advanced soul, fearlessness. That comes to you when you understand basic thing. I'm not this body. Then you become fearless of that because you know I'm not going to die. Okay, if Sudarshan Chakra burns me, that means I did committed offense. So let it burn me. I'm sinner, and I will take birth, be promoted, free from sin. And if it's true that I committed offense, Chakra will burn me. If it's not true, if I'm right that I should punish Ambarish, then Chakra will not burn me. So why should I run away? But Durvasa didn't think like this. Simply heat of Sudarshan Chakra was enough to run away. Bodily conscious of life. Sorry to say, this is what is understood by my tiny impure intelligence. He ran to save his life, to save this body. All right, so now he came to Narayan asking, you are protector of entire universe. What about remembering this one before when you want to kill Ambarish? You didn't thought at that time, Lord, also protector of all the universe and everyone. You know? And you are only desirable object for all devotees. But now he admits, I'm an offender. I'm a great offender, my Lord. Please give me protection. And he's approaching, Lord, I'm also your devotee, so please, you know, like that. Okay. Ajanatate paramanubhavam kritam mayagham bhavatav priyanam videhitasya pachitum vidhata mucheta yannam yudite narakopi. So here, this is text 62. O my Lord, O Supreme Controller, without knowledge of your unlimited powers, I offended your most dear devotee. Now he speaks more truth of it. Without knowledge of your unlimited power, I have offended your most dear devotee. Very kindly save me from the reaction of this offense. You can do everything, but even if a person is fit for going to hell, you can deliver him simply by awakening within his heart the holy name of your Lordship. But again, Durvasa is motivated here, no? He's glorifying Lord. You can do anything. Even if somebody is offended, you can excuse me. Excuse him. So basically, he says, excuse me. Why don't you excuse me? No? So he understood. This is now speaking a little bit with realization that I didn't know that you are above Shiva and Brahma. Obviously, because you went to Brahma and Shiva first to protect you for Sudarshan Chakra. Brahma can protect anybody from Vishnu's weapons. Durvasa, you're not reading Srimad Bhagavatam. The Shiva, he taught his own deity. Now he realized Brahma could not protect him, Shiva could not protect him. That includes all universe. Nobody is there to give protection. So now his ultimate shelter, he must spell it properly. He must offer proper prayers. He must get a favor to achieve, to be saved. Basically, of dying. So here, you can do everything. Even person fit going to hell, he's really giving good example because that's exactly what is going to happen to him. You offend Vaishnava, where you will go? You know? Heavenly planets, no way. You know? Simply, and now he's also beautifully saying, what power, even just by awakening, by chanting your name, sinner who's supposed to go to hell will be saved, such as your power, Lord. So what is for you to deliver me? You know, nothing. basically. True. But then the shloka comes. Text 63, please repeat. Shri Bhagavan Vacham Aham Bhakta Paradinaham Hi Asvatantraham Ivam Vijam Sadubihi Krasta Hridayaham Bhaktaihi Bhakta Janapriyaham Shri Bhagavan Vacham Aham Bhakta Paradhino Yasvatantra Ivadvijam Sadhubhir Krasta Hridayo Bhaktair Bhakta Janapriyaham Shri Bhagavan Vacham. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, Aham, I, Bhakta Paradhinaham, am dependent on the will of my devotees. He, indeed, Asvatantraha, I am not independent. Iva, exactly like that. Dvija, O Brahmana, Sadhubihi, by pure devotees, completely free from all material desires. Krasta Hridayaham, my heart is controlled. Bhaktaihi, because they are devotees. Bhakta Janapriyaha, I am dependent not only on my devotee, but also on my devotee's devotee. The devotee's devotee is extremely dear to me. Translation purport by His Divine Grace, Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Founder Acharya of ISKCON. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said to the Brahmana, I am completely under control of my devotees. Indeed, I am not at all independent, because my devotees are completely devoid of material desires. I sit only within the course of their hearts. What to speak of my devotee? Even those who are devotees of my devotee are very dear to me. Purport. All the great stalwart personalities in the universe, including Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva, are fully under the control of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But the Supreme Personality of Godhead is fully under the control of his devotee. Why is this? Because the devotee is anya bilashita shunya. In other words, he has no material desire in his heart. His only desire is to think always of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and how to serve him best. Because of this transcendental qualification, the Supreme Lord is extremely favorable to the devotee. Indeed, not only devotees, but also the devotees of the devotees. Srila Narottam Das Thakur says, Chardiya Vaishnava Seva Nisthara Paye Chekeva. Without being a devotee of a devotee, one cannot be released from the material entanglement. Therefore, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu identified himself as Gopi Bhartuf Padakamalayor Dasa Dasa Nudasaha. Thus, he has instructed us to become not directly servants of Krishna, but servants of the servants of Krishna. Devotees like Brahma, Narada, Vyasadev, and Shukadev Goswami are directly servants of Krishna. And one who becomes a servant of Narada, Vyasadev, and Shukadev, like the six Goswamis, is still more devoted. Srila Vaishnava Chakravarti Thakur therefore says, Yasya Prasadat Bhagavat Prasadaha. If one very sincerely serves the spiritual master, Krishna certainly becomes favorable to such a devotee. Following the instruction of a devotee is more valuable than following the instruction of the Supreme Personality of Godhead directly. So this is amazing purport here and amazing shloka indeed, where actually Lord declares himself on the pages of Bhagavatam to the whole world that actually he is depending on his devotees. This is a mind-blowing information, because we are always hearing in Sambandha Jnana that Lord is Supreme, Lord is Supreme, Lord is Supreme. Matav parataram nanyat kinchit asti. There is nothing above me. Aswatan. Now Lord say Aswatantra. But we understand he is Swatantra. So many Upanishads, so many places in Puranas, Lord is described as Swatantra. Fully independent. Asama Urdhva. Nobody equal to him. Nobody above him. But Lord now reveals his mind. He reveals his dealings with his devotees. He reveals how he feels. That yes, I am supreme, but voluntarily I subjugate myself to my devotees. I become subordinate to my devotees. In the sense that not that I lost my power and I put somebody else to be supreme, but I want to fulfill their desires. I will do what they say. I will act for their pleasure. Just like devotee is eager to serve the Lord is also eager to do something for the pleasure of his devotee. Kaunteya pratijani name bhakta pralanshati. Lord is always ready to protect his devotees. So here, this is very amazing that Durvasa Muni, who is impersonalist, who is great Vedic scholar, who is tapasvi, he's hearing this and he's astonished. How to understand this? You are not independent. Then who is independent? You are Supreme Lord. I understood Brahma is not supreme. I understood Shiva is not supreme. And I know you are supreme. And now you say, I'm not independent. So it's a shock for Durvasa. And this is beauty of Bhagavatam here, that Lord's mind is revealed, his heart is revealed here, not his powers only. That is already described throughout. But now look at this, Lord is saying, I'm not independent. Because my devotees are fully free from material desires, I'm so obliged. This is the point of bondage between the devotee and Krishna. Now, not that because Lord is supreme, we will do all kinds of material things and still expect Lord to serve us, that he will be excusing us. No? That's not the point. The point is opposite. When one is free from material desires and do not desire anything else than service to the Lord, then Lord will do anything for him. We are always counting, Lord is merciful, Lord is merciful. Then he will excuse us whatever nonsense we do. That sounds a little bit like Christianity, that you do all kinds of sins and then you come Sunday to church and confess and ask forgiveness, and then Monday again, elephant bath, no? Take good bath, purify yourself by confessing, and then as soon as you come out, do sin again. You elephant sprinkle some mud on his body as soon as he comes out of the water. So we should not be like that. Somebody showed me the discussion on Twitter between devotees. Devotees and friends of devotees, or let's see what kind of devotees are after you hear discussion. Discussion goes on like this. Can we eat chocolate? So another devotee replies, yeah, it's vegetarian. No. And another devotee, no, but we should not eat chocolate. And then another devotee say, come on, Krishna is so kind, he's not going to send you to hell for chocolate. No. So this is Durvasa Muni's approach. That you did some offense, something inappropriate, but you count on Lord's mercy now. No? And you think Lord will be obliged to fulfill. But Lord said, no, I'll fulfill obligations of those who are pure in the heart. And those who are pure in the heart, they don't have these desires for material enjoyment, not even for chocolate. So you may say, Lord will not send you to hell for eating chocolate. True, Lord is not person who will send you to hell for eating chocolate, but you don't expect that you'll go to Vaikuntha also. He will not send you to hell, but he will not send you to Vaikuntha also. Why? Because this is not bhakti if you want to eat something which is not offerable to the Lord. If you're not ready to give up little chocolate for Lord's pleasure, how are you going to give up all material world? So, we are not in the position to claim, I'm your devotee. Devotee is one who is free from all material desires, anya vilashita shunya. Then Lord forgives and takes care and maintains. Yeyata mam prapadyante. So you don't want to give up little chocolate? Why should Lord reciprocate with you? Why do you expect that? Huh? Yeah, you'll not go to hell, but you'll not get bhakti also. Because you are eating something which is not prasadam, which is not offerable. No? And then the fellow comes, Supreme Acharya comes and says, Prabhupada ate chocolate. But ask us, just see how he's quoting, you know? No? Yes, Prabhupada tried once because Shyamasundara Prabhu came from Switzerland and he taught, what are the best things to offer to my spiritual master? And those are early days, you know, they're like unclear with all the rules and regulations in the Shastras, you know. He thought, famous Swiss chocolate, one white one, one black one, let me bring to Prabhupada. I'm coming from Switzerland. Everybody will ask me, hey, you came from Swiss, where is the chocolate? So he thought, I'll give it to my Guru Maharaj. That was his attitude. That was his devotion to Prabhupada. You know, I'll offer him. It's up to him to try. So he brought some chocolate to Prabhupada. What is it? Swiss chocolate. Prabhupada, you want to try? With love and devotion, he brought, okay. So Prabhupada took it. All right. Finish. Now Prabhupada said, every day on my plate, chocolate. And later on, when devotees ask about this chocolate distribution, Harishari Prabhu asked, somebody in Vrindavan wanted to distribute some chocolate ring. Prabhupada said, what is this nonsense chocolate? Stop it. So it's not approved. It's bluff. It was accepting devotion of his devotee, a little bit, you know. And this is now quoted, this is the Shastra, Prabhupada ate chocolate. So they will quote anything to make excuse for themselves to eat, you know. But then can you claim yourself devotee? You know? What is chocolate to give up? We have such a nice sweets in Krishna consciousness prasadam. We can replace any chocolate. What is a chocolate? Nonsense, you know, compared to sandesh and rasgullas and rabri and rasmalai, you know, and gulab jamuns and son papri. What is the problem in chocolate? Chocolate is insignificant, correct? Can't give up chocolate. How are you going to give up sex life? Okay, next topic. So that's the point, that Durvasa is trying to use the Shastra, trying to use his knowledge of Lord to simply save himself. So this is very dishonest way approaching the Shastra, approaching the Guru, approaching the Prabhupada's quotes. Try to justify yourself for doing something really materialistic, material, you know. Simply you want to, you know, it's not proper. So here, the beauty of this shloka is that Lord declares to everyone openly how much he likes his devotees. That I'm in their heart. I am one with their thought, whatever the. Now you offended my devotee. How am I going to excuse you? How is this possible? How? Why should I excuse you? You are not devotee, you are impersonalist. Why should I excuse you? I declare that I protect my devotees, and if I excuse you, then everybody will go on offending my devotees. Then I'm breaking my own rule. Then I'm putting in harm my devotees, which is not possible. Durvasa, I'm not going to help you. There's no way I'm not stopping Sudarshan Chakra. And Durvasa is shocked here. Where to go now? Lord still didn't tell him where to go. He will tell him. That's kindness of the Lord. But, you know, look at this. He's puzzled. He's gone now. Now the peak of the fear. And Chakra is waiting, standing behind, already caught up with him. He's standing in front of Narayana and Chakra is there waiting. And is looking at him, not with most pleasing eyes. So, and looking at command of the Lord. If Lord just like this, just a little movement of eyebrow, Durvasa is gone. And he knows this now. Heat he's feeling from behind. You know, maybe in higher you go, scientist is more cold, but Durvasa felt very hot. Yeah. So what is the point? The point is that he thought, definitely, Lord will protect Brahmana. This is what he was playing card on, that definitely I'm the Brahmana, Lord, protect me. And you see, I offer prayers in Sanskrit, you know, and I quoted the Shastras, and you know, I'm Lord is so kind. And but did not happen. He's shocked. He's impersonalist. He does not know about bhakti. He does not know Lord's feelings. He does not know how to deal with it. If he knew about bhakti before, he will not dare to offend devotee. No? He will not dare to harm devotee. But he didn't know about that. So Lord thought, okay, now I'm going to show to all world, and Durvasa, and all impersonalists and yogis, and all the speculators, don't mess up with my devotees. Nothing will help you. I will not protect you. So this is why is like this? Why it must come like, it must be like this, because they are so dear to Krishna. So dear. They're so much in the heart of the Lord. Just as this Lord is in their heart, they are in the Lord's heart. So you harm devotee, he feels more pain than harming the Lord. When Bhrigu Muni came and kicked Lord in his chest with his foot to test whether who is the supreme. Remember the famous Leela from Bhagavatam and other Puranas also describe. He insulted verbally Lord Brahma, Bhrigu Muni, and then mentally he insulted Lord Shiva, something like that. And then physically, the worst offense, And then he went to the Lord Vishnu and kicked him with the foot. The worst offense, physical, gross one. The transcendental body of the Lord, he touched with his foot. That's really offense. And purposely he did. And Lord understood. He knows everything. He understood. And he didn't mind. He didn't say anything. Lord was kicked by the foot in the chest. And he did not call his Sudarshan Chakra. He said, oh, Bhrigu, is your foot hurt? My chest are very hard. I'll do a little massage. He excused him. No? But now, his devotee is threatened. There is no excuse. There is no excuse. Now the Lord we use for his own protection. He doesn't have to need any protection or anything like that. And he will excuse easily offender to himself. But who offends his devotee, Lord will not excuse. That's called bhakti. That is Lord's love for his devotee, sure. Usually when we talk bhakti, we speak bhakti of devotee towards the Lord. But here we are talking about bhakti of Lord towards his devotees. Because of that, this situation happened. And Lord is now happily declaring, Hyaswa Tantra, I'm not independent. All Shastras say I'm independent, but I say I'm not independent. How voluntarily I put myself in the hand of my devotees. Because they are pure, they will not misuse that. They will not misuse. Okay, Krishna, now I am supreme. Now I will do the Ras Lila. No, devotees, they don't do that because they are free from material desires in the heart. Therefore, Lord can give them everything. You know? You don't put anybody in charge for that nuclear weapon button to press, no? You cannot. Not everybody. Only most trained, confidential person who is trained, who can control his mind, he is given the charge. So similarly, devotee, when he is loved by Krishna, he gets all the power, all the siddhis, all the mystic powers, all the whatever he wants can happen. No? It's possible. But devotees, they do not misuse that. They simply want to use everything in Krishna service. So here, this is this exchanges with the Lord and His devotee, and it's amazing. So then Lord says, Aham bhakta paradino. I'm dependent on the will of my devotees. So Durvasa was shocked here. Oh, I thought Lord would say. Just he said, okay, and everything is over. But he said, I depend on will of my devotees. It's some, Durvasa is simply hearing some excuse not to save me. But Lord wants to teach him that you must understand that this never happens again anywhere in the universe, by you or by anybody else. Nobody should mess up with my devotees. Although they have seen my angry form as Narasimhadev, still, which lila happened first? This lila or Narasimha lila? Narasimha lila. At least it was in 7th canto. This is in 9th canto. So we assume, not necessary because Bhagavata is not chronological in that sense by time, but we assume. And Lord said, already I show you, if you touch my devotee, I really get angry. Really get angry. How much love for his devotee, this much anger came. And the anger, you cannot, the Lord say, this human form doesn't express anger fully, but the lion form does express, really, you know. Might and anger, both are expressed, you know. So Lord changed his face into lion's face, start roaring around and showing his teeth. You know, that's the quality of anger from his tremendous love for his devotee. So the Lord is saying to Durvasa, I already show you, if you touch my devotee, what happens. And now you want to kill my devotee. You want to kill Ambarish, who is 24 hours engaged in my service, who is fasting, who is not enjoying his kingdom. He went to Vrindavan to worship me. And you, fellow, come, who did nothing for me, everything you do for yourself, your studies for yourself, your tapasya is for your own power, your knowledge is for prestige and getting more disciples. Nothing you did for me. Why should I protect you? And why should I not protect your devotee who took full shelter of me? Who is Savaimana Padaravinda, who is fully with mind, heart, body, words engaged in my service. He didn't, what? Where is the logic behind that? I have to protect. I want to protect my devotee. And then Lord goes one step further. He said, Durvasa, nothing you understand. Nothing you understood from all your studies of Vedas, all your tapasyas, all your, you know, pujas, vratas, nothing you understood. Not that only I'm depending on my devotee, but he says, what is it? He says Sadhubri Grasta Hridaya, Bhaktair, Bhakta Janapriyaha, that what to speak of my devotee, even those who are devotees of my devotee are very dear to me. Now this is one more step further, Lord says. Even devotees of my devotees are dear to me, because this devotee is so dear. If you render a little service to him, oh, you are serving my devotee. You are my devotee. Immediately you are accepted by Lord. He is also dear to me. You may feel I'm not devotee, but let me do some service to the devotee of the Lord. The Lord said, no, you are devotee. Now I accept you as a devotee. And here, Durvasa is declaring, Lord, I'm also your devotee. No, that's what he says. No, save me. Even, you know, what is it? You save everyone. You protect, you are the protector of entire universe. You know. This is how he said. So Durvasa said, I also glorify Lord, I offer him prayer, I'm also your devotee. But Lord said, no, you are not my devotee. Directly you are approaching me. No, not like that. You worship my devotee. And you fool, you are offending my devotee. You want to kill my devotee. How you are my devotee? One who is dasa, dasa, anudas, who is servant of my devotee. That is my devotee. And you want to kill my devotee and say, you are also my devotee. You're bluffing, Durvasa. It doesn't work like this. Everything was stopped. Everything was ruined for Durvasa. There was no hope. After hearing the shloka, Durvasa simply shrunk his shoulders, oh, I'm finished. No? Sudarshan Chakra was smiling. Where you will go now? Because that is the weapon that protects devotees. And he finds pleasure in that, because Lord's order is there, protect my devotee. So this is that Lord, even devotees of his devotees are dear to him. There was a famous that Leela from Chaitanya Charitamrita. You remember that Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya invited Lord Chaitanya for lunch. And him and wife, they prepared many items, and they brought from Jagannath Puri many items also. So when Lord came, he accepted the invitation for lunch. When Lord came to Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's house and saw so much prasadam, he said, this is for 10, 12 people, you know. You are unreasonable, you know, you cook too much. So Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya kind of transcendentally joked with the Lord, I know how much you can eat. In Dwaraka, 16,000 wives cook for you, and their mothers also. And in Puri, you accept 52 items every day. And, in Vrindavan, your mother, and then Baladev's mother, and then their friends, and their all their gopis, everybody cooks for you. And every day you eat in everyone's house. So I know how much you can eat. So Chaitanya smiled, okay, let me sit there. But he's now playing Leela of Sannyasi. So he was not... He hinted him, look, okay, you are devotee, I'll accept, but you should not do this because people criticize. I'm sannyasi, you can't display so many items, it's too much. I'm supposed to eat, like a bhikshu, a little bit, But Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, great scholar, he knew who is the Lord. So he said, no, I know how much you can eat. Like that. So he went on, he started serving the Lord, and his son-in-law, Amoga, he was not devotee. He was son-in-law of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, but he was, at that point of time, he was not a devotee. So he came in, he wanted to see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's eating, but his mind was always critical, always fault-finding. So then he commented, oh, how much this sannyasi is eating for 10, 12 people? He commented, and Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, furious, he took a stick and ran after him. But Damoga was younger, he ran away. And you know what the embarrassment? You are inviting somebody in your house and your son-in-law comments. You know how embarrassing is this? And he's inviting Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He's very life and soul. You know how bad Sarvabhaumacharya felt. Really, he felt bad. That I invited you only to offend you. This is what has happened. My Lord, Chaitanya said, Sarvabhauma said, sorry for this. No, he's right. Look how many items. He spoke the truth. There is no offense. This is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said. He spoke the truth. Look how many items you brought. Definitely I'm overeating. He's right. He said the truth. There is no offense. Sarvabhauma felt so bad. Him and wife, they start cursing son-in-law. Let my daughter-in-law become widow. Let him die. That's only remedy for offense to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And he was really, really, really sorrowful, feeling apologetic at his heart. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took it lightly. Come on, it's okay, just leave it. So the next day, Amoga got cholera, cursed by Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya and wife. There's no way. No? Got cholera, he was dying. And when who came? Gopinath Acharya, he came to inform Chaitanya Mahaprabhu this. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he heard that Amoga, son-in-law of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, is dying of cholera, he just ran immediately to his place, and tell him, put hand on his chest and told him that your heart is placed for seat for Krishna. It's Krishna's seat, the heart. We should keep Krishna in our heart. But you kept this demon of committing offenses, fault-finding. So remove that demon, purify your heart, and put Krishna in your heart. Chant Hare Krishna. So Amoga immediately started chanting Hare Krishna, jump in the air, no more fever, no more cholera. And not only that, but he got Prem Bhakti. This is how Chaitanya Mahaprabhu preached around. This is how he spread Krishna Bhakti. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Most merciful. So Amoga, not only that he was cured from cholera, but he became a great devotee. And then he understood what he did. So he was really so sorrowful, so remorseful. He started slapping himself. He started slapping his own cheeks, Amoga. He became red and swollen so much. And the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told him, stop him, it's okay. You know, you are Sarvabhauma's son-in-law. There's no question, you know. Just leave it, there's no offense, finish. And then Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya was, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to meet him, he said, why did you save him? Let him die. Better if he died. Then only he'll be free from offense. You know? And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said that, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, you are so dear to me. You're my devotee. You and your wife and your relatives, maids, servants in the house. Even a dog in your house is dear to me. What to speak of Amoga, your son-in-law? You see that? You see how Lord says, because when we are devotees, when somebody becomes pure devotee, this is how Lord says, anybody related to him becomes dear to me. When Lord Nrisingha saved, blessed Hiranyakashipu, give him moksha, he said to Prahlad Maharaj, 20 generations I will deliver. Whoever is linked with you becomes dear to me. No? And this is how devotees who are serving full-time brahmacharis, we know that we left our families, we left our maybe elder parents, maybe in need sometimes also. But we left them because we know this, that if we serve Krishna full-time, 24 hours a day, selflessly, the Lord will take care of everyone. Automatically happen. Not that for that purpose we are serving. But we know that service to Lord does it all. Everything is yata taror mula nishechana. When you put water in the root of the tree, everything is settled. So Lord will take care of everything. Nothing to worry. We are serving full time. This is our faith. This is our understanding. And we are doing best for everyone, for family, for society, for the universe, for the devatas, for ourselves, for everyone. The best. There is no better occupation than pure devotional service to the Lord. And here you can see how Lord is pleased. Just we should not get into some funny mood that I'm devotee, so no problem. Devotee should always think, I'm not yet devotee. I'm aspiring to be devotee. I'm trying to be devotee. I'm not pure devotee. And then in that state of mind, you can progress. But if you think, I'm devotee, I can eat outside food, I can, go to cinema, I can do material enjoyment, but I'm devotee. You don't see tilak? You don't see shika? I'm devotee. So what makes you devotee is the consciousness and the attitude and really love for Krishna. Once you love Krishna, you will not do all these things. Very fact that we are doing all these things, it shows us that we are not yet devotees. That's the very fact. Not that we are devotees so we can do anything. Krishna will protect us. No. We are devotees because we do what Krishna wants us to do, what Guru wants us to do. That's really a show of devotion. No? So that understanding should be there. Not that now I'm devotee and Krishna will forgive us. I'm chanting. He's very pleased with me. So what is this little chocolate? No problem. What is this? You know. But we offer everything. Even if we go to, what is it called? Sarvana Bhavan. Even if we go to Sarvana Bhavan, some famous restaurants in South India, now they are all over the world, it seems like, you know. We offer. We are such a strict devotee. We always offer. But why you eat food cooked by karmis if you are devotee? Why? You are not sincere devotee. A neophyte devotee. You know. So, that is understanding, that we should always think ourselves, we are not yet devotees. Therefore, I have to follow more strictly. Ah, you can eat. You're pure devotee. You can eat anyway. I cannot. I'm neophyte. I'll get others' karma. I'll not advance. My mind will be disturbed. I cannot chant. I cannot serve. Oh, I'm neophyte. I have to follow strictly. You are pure devotee. You will eat wherever you want to eat. And that is the fact. Prabhupada could eat one small tiny piece of chocolate and not be affected. Because he didn't eat it as an enjoyer. He didn't eat, oh, chocolate, very nice. He then gave a fig. He saw just love of his devotee offering him something which is not even offerable. He said, kind, merciful. He accepted. And because he is pure devotee, nothing affected him. No? But we will be affected. We will be polluting our consciousness by it. We will be having problems in spiritual life. So if this much you cannot do for Krishna, how we are going to do full Sharanagati? How is it possible? It's illusion. So that mentality of maintaining enjoyer status while chanting, while putting tilak and thinking I'm devotee, that won't bring us to the platform where Lord declares, oh, this is my devotee. So that is what is the message, that one should not really think ourselves, I'm great devotee. You know? That's what Durvasa taught. I'm great Rishi. Who is this king? But king was Vaishnava. King was devotee. King was serving 24 hours a day. You know? That's his qualification. That is devotee. So this is very interesting Leela, and now more beautiful shlokas are coming, very nice purpose, so we'll continue hearing here. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Any comments, questions, realizations? Anybody wants to eat chocolate? Something? Yes. Did Durvasa Muni see Vishnu? Okay. Now, how he could see the Vishnu if he is not devotee? How he could go to Vaikuntha? Right. Okay, so this is explained in Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur's commentary here. That to prove this point, that only by dasa, dasa, no dasa, only by being servant of the Lord, one can see the Lord. Lord said that Durvasa, I am in the hands of my devotees. I follow their lead. And then the Lord narrated the story to Durvasa when Dwaraka was attacked by 10 great demons. Narada Muni and Durvasa were there. So Narada Muni said to Durvasa, go to Sutala Loka, where Lord Vamanadev lives there, at the gate protecting the Bali Maharaj's palace. And Bali Maharaj, who lives with Bali Maharaj, yeah? Go there and call Vamanadev to protect the Dwaraka. There was Leela described in Puranas. At that time, Durvasa, sent by Narada Muni, went to Sutala and approached Vamanadev, that please come, Dwaraka is at attack. And Vamanadev replied, go and ask Bali Maharaj permission. Because if I leave, his heart will break. He cannot live in separation of me. We are so close. So Durvasa went to Bali Maharaj and said, look, Dwaraka is burning. I have to, Lord Vamana has to come and save us. And Bali Maharaj said, oh, I cannot bear that he leaves. And Vamanadev never went to Dwaraka. He never left. Don't worry, nothing happened to Dwaraka. Lord is omnipotent. He saved Dwaraka in a different way. But Vamanadev did not leave because Bali Maharaj said, no, you cannot leave. Then Lord Vishnu said, Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur commentary here on this shloka. There is a beautiful book, Sadhu Hridaya Mahayam, when Shivaram Maharaj explained this Leela. Full book, he explained just this Leela of the Lord. And he quotes from Jiva Goswami, from Sanatana Goswami, and particularly from Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur there. So he said that, you see, how you could see me in Sutala, Durvasa? Because Narada Muni, my devotee, sent you. Because Narada say, go there and see the Lord, I show myself to you. Otherwise, you as an impersonalist, you have no power to see me. So then Durvasa understood, oh, my Lord, because Shiva sent me to Vaikuntha to see you, is that why I'm seeing you? And Lord say, yes, because my devotees send you, therefore I show myself to you. But then later on, Lord say, but even what you see now is not my true form, because you're still not devotee, you cannot see my true form. So this is kind of reflection of the Lord's original form. This is what Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur writes. Because he was impersonalist, he could not see the form. So Vishnu says to Durvasa, what you see now is not actually my form which I showed to my devotees. Because you are impersonalist, because I want to teach you something, because Shiva said you can come and see me, I show you some form, but not the form I will reveal to my devotees. So this is the answer to your question. Did Durvasa see the Vishnu? No. He could come close and talk to him in some form, but that's by the mercy of devotees also. It's a very nice lila. So many things to learn in this particular lila of the Lord. Okay, any other comments, questions? Thank you. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Gaur Premanande.